It's a privilege to be here with People First. I think one of the more vital agencies that are going to be involved in creating the futures we want. Want to begin with a poem, and it's a silly little poem, sort of. It's called Bugs in a Bowl by David Budbill. Hanshan, that great and crazy, wonder-filled poet of 1,000 years ago, once said, "We're just like bugs in a bowl, all day, going around, never leaving the bowl." I say, yeah, that's right, pretty much. Every day, climbing up steep sides, falling back over and over again, around and around, up and back down. So, sit in the bottom of the bowl, cry, moan, feel sorry for yourself, or look around the bowl, say, "Hi, how you doing? Nice bowl." That's our 2 hours in a short poem. And I think it's important because we don't get to make all the decisions, but there is a really important decision we get to make every day when we get up. How are we going to greet the world? And we can choose to look around at the same set of facts and be completely depressed and demoralized and crying and moaning and carrying on. And some of that's completely justified. But on those same days, we can also look around and say, it's crispy out there today, fresh air. And we can reach out and choose to face the world differently. Nice bowl. That we can do, and it makes all the difference. And one of the reasons we're delighted to be here with People First is that People First, I think, is a leader globally in helping us to remember, to notice the obvious, that you can make a difference in how you are every day, anywhere. So, nice to be here. Linda.
I'm Linda, and our friend and colleague, Peter Block, says, "The leadership task is to issue the invitation and then engage those who show up. You be the people that showed up." And the folks who issued the invitation are People First of Brockville, and this is a glorious, diverse collection of people from this great community. And the conversations we're going to have today are going to be about what makes this a good community and how's that work? And what are things we want to keep and what are things we want to do better? And so we're really excited to be part of that. Jack and I live in Toronto. And we're part of this little adventure that's called Inclusion Press. You may have seen our catalogs as you came in. And so we've been publishing stories about people being engaged in everyday life, people who are often pushed to the margin, stories that nobody else wanted to tell, and that's our work. And we feel really, really fortunate to be back here in Brockville, and this is the third community conversation that we're part of. One has happened in Welland, another happened just this past Friday in Tilsonburg. This is the first community to have two events scheduled in a day because there were going to be so many people who wanted to be part of the conversation, which is pretty wonderful. And then we'll be in Huntsville and in Peterborough before the week is up. We wanted a chance actually for people to be able to look around the room and see something about who else is in the room. So it is still incredibly cold outside from my point of view. And there are definitely going to be people in this room who think that's the good news because they really love to ski. Who are the people in the room who love skiing? Just raise your hand. Take a look, okay? A few skiers, okay? Hockey. Anybody hockey? Okay? All right, we get a few more with hockey. Any other winter sports anybody wants to call out that you're engaged in? You want to find out anybody else in the room?
Snowmobiling.
Okay, who we got? Oh, I'm so sorry, Denny. You know, you? Yeah, okay. I think Carson is outdoors a lot. Okay, so who can't wait for the thaw because you like to play in the mud and do gardening? Okay. How about people who any time of year really enjoy dancing? Right, this is going to be very self-serving because we're going to have a list of things that I really love. How about people who are involved in music, play a musical instrument? Yeah, okay. Shout it out, what do you play?
Piano.
Voice.
Guitar.
You added another.
I play drums.
He plays drums.
Hey, drums. Anybody else play drums? Your instrument?
Guitar.
Great. Okay, they're the beginnings of a band. People who really like to sing, whether it's in the shower or in a choir. In my car. In my car, singers. Okay. Anything else that you're curious about? Who else is interested in that too?
Kayaking.
Oh, yeah, okay. All right. Who likes being on the water? Kayaking? Okay. Admitting that. Some of us, not very good. Some of us canoe tippers and kayak tippers, but love to be out there.
Tennis.
Okay, there's lots more room on the tennis court. There you go. Okay, what are you? Fishing. Who likes to feed the fish or go fishing? Yes. Okay. Right. How about crafty things? Quilting, weaving. Okay. What in particular have you got there? Betting. Okay, you knit? You're in Mary Knits? Bobby?
Rock cooking.
Oh, great.
Summer indoor sports, soccer, baseball.
Okay, outdoor sports, soccer, baseball. Soccer has been very, very good to me. Okay, yeah. Yeah, baseball? What do you got, Kimberly?
Oh, I just really like to sit outside on my deck in the sun and watch the squirrels and birds and have a coffee. That's what I'm waiting for.
Okay, the deck sitters. The deck sitters, yes? Yes? How many people have a deck or a porch on the front of their house where you can really see what else is going by in the neighborhood, right? Very important in this community thing. Well, that's great. Okay, that's great. Thanks for that. Well, the mischief we're going to be up to today kind of stems from an idea that that we've heard about called the World Cafe. And it's an idea based on the notion that conversation is the way we humans think together. That's how we do it. Fish need water, people need to talk. And so we're going to be posing some big questions that people at the table are going to talk about and hear what one another have to say. So along with that idea, I want to read a poem from Margaret Wheatley. Sure. It's from her book called Turning to One Another. And she says, there is no power greater than a community discovering what it cares about. Ask what's possible, not what's wrong. Keep asking. Notice what you care about. Assume that many others share your dreams. Be brave enough to start a conversation that matters. Talk to people you know. Talk to people you don't know. Talk to people you never talk to. Be intrigued by the differences you hear. expect to be surprised, treasure curiosity more than certainty, invite in everybody who cares to work on what's possible, acknowledge that everyone is an expert about something, know that creative solutions come from new connections. Remember, you don't fear people whose story you know. Real listening always brings people closer together. Trust that meaningful conversations can change your world. Rely on human goodness. Stay together. And so, with that idea of talking to people you never talk to and being curious, we're thinking that some people have come in and they don't know who they're sitting with, and other people are sitting with a five-pack of people they already know pretty well. Well, the first round of this conversation, you can stay where you are. And what we're going to do is pose a question, and there's a blank piece of paper on your table, and we would invite everyone to be able to take off the caps of the markers, and you're going to doodle and draw, and you're going to listen as people around your table will answer the question, and everybody can write some of the key ideas they hear. It's just a way to keep track. It's fun. It's a way to kind of look at what you've said, and everyone at the table is just going to make space to make sure that everybody has a chance to contribute what they think, speak from your heart, talk about what you think about the question. You'll be thinking to connect ideas and listen for patterns. That's the etiquette, if you will, of a World Cafe. So everybody can doodle. No one person's in charge. Without further ado, the first question we would like you to talk about is, what's good about community life here? And how do these good things work?
Okay, is as you're carrying on your conversation, there are going to be three post-it notes coming to each table. And we are going to gather the individual and collective wisdom from this community and begin to organize it, because we know that there's a lot of capacity here. What we want to do is see it. And we want to begin with noticing what's the really good stuff in this community. So we want to start from that place. So pick your three top and a nice big headline in a colorful color so people can read it. Not a paragraph, just a headline. But three key things about Brockville, an area here, things that are really working well. What are your three top? Gather those and we'll begin posting them in a couple of minutes. So
I hadn't even noticed, but when we turned around, leaned into the conversation at one of the tables here is Brockville's mayor, David Henderson. And I asked him if he would say a welcome, as he was invited by people first to do. Way to go.
I would like to say thank you for coming out, and congratulations to the group for initiating the discussion. Because as we found out, between school board, health unit, the YMCA, multiple different groups in the community, we started different discussions over the last year or so about how to get more interactive and more community-oriented. And they have lots of different words for it. Policing community uses the words hubs, and safe community is an aspect of that. But basically, how do you get more organizations working together to be inclusive, to basically start from the ground up? And so I found it interesting that you were doing this type of an organization. I don't know a great deal of the details of it, but I got to tell you, so far, sitting at the table, it's like a hug in here, and I'm loving it right now. So you'll see that in a minute. But clearly, there's a tone, and it's encouraging to see. So congratulations.
Well, with that, we want to connect into actually inviting one person from every table to come up with those post-it notes, those yellow post-it notes you did, and we're going to have you kind of form a line right across this end of the room, because you're going to going to be a bit of a chorus. People are going to just read out exactly what's on the cards. Trust the force, Luke, it will work. So we just need one person from every table to come up with those post-it notes. The table voluntold the mayor. Who's going to be voluntold in your table?
Generous, open, and accepting.
People join clubs, leagues, groups, networks. It connects us great outdoors and the great outdoors of the region.
Caring, we look out for one another. All means all. We are moving towards full inclusion and acceptance. Connected, people feel part of the community.
Social support and services, friendly people, social opportunities.
Growth and collaboration, thoughtful people, and a tight geography.
Safe communities, support services, and events and festivals.
Lots of activities and events that are accessible. People's minds are opening up and more accepting.
People able to live in their own home in a great neighborhood. People care. People first are very strong, and tourism and recreation are spurred the river and the castles.
Interconnectedness, generous and engaging, and leadership.
Okay, so Jack is going to organize those so you can stick them up, and Jack will organize them into themes. Thank you very much. Okay, let's hear it for the choir. There are times that we've noticed that in these conversations that when you come to thinking about it in these themes with the ideas on the post-it notes, that maybe there's some more of the conversation you were having that people just want to add into the room right now. Anything else that came up at your table that you feel really needs to be mentioned, or you want to say a few more words about the idea you had about what's good about community life here. Anything else that anybody wants to be able to add?
It's also, oops, I'm stepping on stuff here. It's also getting to know one another as a community, helping one another, and seeing everybody's needs and responsibilities to one another's help. Also, when in need, get involved in activities like in the summer, getting together, doing a fundraise to help our own needs. Also, saying thank you to all the people in the community for their contributions.
Thanks very much. So, Jack, have you got the, were you able to grab that? No, the paper's falling on his head, so he's not. Kimberly, can you just do a doodle about the ideas that that Christina raised. You talked about, just so that we catch them, and I'll catch up with Jack to put them up there. You talked about the importance of thank you and appreciation, people looking out for each other. And there was one other idea, and I'm sorry if I missed it. Do you remember what you said? Because you were on a roll.
Okay, I think it has to do with thanking each other.
Right, so thanking each other and really appreciating the contributions of people. And you know, one of the things that we didn't actually ask in the ways that people are spending their time, we talked about outdoor sports and sitting on the porch and those kinds of things. Can we see a hand of everyone who's involved in some way, in some kind of voluntary effort or organization? Yeah. Uh-huh. Okay. And we may well want actually to create a post-it note that we give you on the table where folks have a chance in one of these rounds to just write that down in terms of the ways that, that people are connected. Thanks for that. That's great. Okay, so in a moment, I'm going to put up the second question. Before I do that, Jack, do you want to just do a quick summary of what you got? Okay.
Okay. This sounds like a pretty neat community. And the reason we're starting here is lots of people, when they're planning, begin with the list of what's wrong. And we want to flip that on its head, because we think that Brockville is already an outstanding community, and what we want to notice and honor and nurture is all the great stuff that's already happening. So we've got a pretty fabulous start here. And there's this incredible cluster, and when you see them clustered, you know it's got a heartbeat. And there's many people use different words and connections for the same kind of stuff, but people talk about this being an open and accepting and inclusive and connected community. And those are words where there's growth and collaboration, connection. And it's connected to great outdoors and to tourism and all that kind of stuff, but it's also connected by being very tight into social activities for lots of people, where there are events and festivals, and they're safe, and there's support services that allow people to be full participants in those social opportunities that are sports and music and so on. And the spirit of those is welcoming and generous and engaging. And generous was a word that came up a couple of times. And generous got sort of played out a little bit because it signals that we are a caring community. And caring was a word that came up several times. We're accepting, we're friendly, we're caring. And we're welcoming of people. And that includes very, very practical, solid things like I'm able to live in my own home. And that means that you can nurture and appreciate and say thank you, but also create a safe space where an organization like People First is offering leadership and strength to not only this community, but the province and beyond. I think that's slice of the incredible capacities that you have noticed, and congratulations for what you've already done to build that in your community. Linda.
So with that first round of conversation, we want to actually create a little mayhem and have people mix it up and move to another table, except for one person who will stay at the table. Just one person is going to be the anchor at the table. They'll have some of the seeds from the conversation you just had, and everybody else is going to move, but not as a four-pack. So much as you just enjoyed the conversation of the people you were with, we'd like you to spread out. Some people could travel far distances from one part of the room to the other. This is a chance to sit with a different group of people to have the next conversation, and I'll put the question up once everybody settles. Please do it now. As you begin the next round of conversation, if we've mixed it up well, you actually will not know everyone at the table. So as you begin to have the conversation, please lean in, say hello, introduce yourselves to each other, and speak to this question for the next 15 minutes. When we think about a good future for everyone in our communities, what do we want to keep? And what do we want to do better? What do we want to keep? And what do we want to do better?
Okay, about 4 minutes, and surprise, surprise, you now have new, fresh post-it notes. And we want you to write on the nice blue ones. What we want to keep, your top three. And what we want to work on the nice, bright, pinky, orangey, ready ones. So three and three, and you get 2 minutes. You've already done the homework. Just make it nice and clear so people can read
them. And the last minute here to get the ideas on there, and Shane is going to come visiting to each table. These folks are ready. And so what we like to have is Shane's going to be hearing from the spokesperson at the table to say, what do you want to keep? What do you want to do better? And then Rena is going to take those post-it notes up to Jack.
We want to keep strong public institutions. Keep a focus on the tremendous inclusion efforts that we've been making and maintain the caring neighborhood atmosphere, which is many times lost in the urban centers.
May I have the tables ready?
Great. Things we want to do better is housing for all is $4. And educational support.
So the things we want to keep are our sense of inclusion, our strong volunteer base, and our quality accessible transportation. The things we want to do better are access to existing buildings, making them accessible, after hours transportation, and affordable housing.
We would like to keep freedom and opportunities. We would like to keep improving and inclusiveness. For do better, we like skill building, expanding community attitudes, and putting all people first abilities.
Keep volunteers, keep the leadership, and keep jobs. And do better, more opportunities for leadership, do better, more volunteers needed, and to do better, more and better jobs.
We want to keep the beauty of this area, the rivers, the rural area, the wildlife. We want to keep the small town feeling, the generosity, the sense of caring, the sense of neighborhood, and we want to keep an intergenerational community.
And to do better is addressing poverty, look at things from a strength-based approach, and just improving support services.
So we want to keep, like many people, the wonderful volunteers in our community. We want to keep our generous community. We want to keep and build our interconnectedness and working together. We want to do better with accessibility with both pedestrian and bicycle and pathways. We want to do better at connecting and providing transportation for people who do not have their own vehicles so that they can access our great community. And we want to do better with developing an online calendar to have a central hub of all the calendar and events that happen in our community.
Who's up here?
Keep sense of belonging. Keep services and community life. Keep opportunities to connect. Do better and continue to improve our support services. Do better at keeping our community safe. And do better at building comfort for all.
Okay, for keeps, helping people to stay in their own homes, independence, and helping one another. For our do better communities?
Yeah, I better read that.
I'll let him say this.
Okay, I wrote this, so I better read it. Community groups need to be more accessible as a default. Community-wide awareness of inclusive and accessibility. And we want to do better expanding the all means all in our schools. Sorry about that.
Some of the things that we would like to keep are affordable housing, as well as our services, police and fire, as well as all of the support systems and support services. And to keep all of our wonderful volunteers in the community share their thanks to the groups. Things that we would like to do better and continue improving upon is educating other people, increasing accessibility, and increasing services and awareness to people.
Thanks very much for that, ma'am. Shane, if you will take that portable mic to my boyfriend Jack, we'll see what kind of miracle he can work in a summary. What everybody has just said. And then as you listen into this, we'll pause after the things we want to keep to see if there are any things that people want to particularly add that didn't come up there that are important. And then we'll summarize the what can we do better, and we'll listen in for anything that people feel is important to add or they want to say a few more words about to explain. He's dancing as fast as he can.
Okay. Greedy people. You've got a lot of good stuff you want to hang on to. And you're right. You're really right. Because one of the elements that's underneath your capacity to do all these things is there's a strong voluntary commitment deep in the heart of this community. And so we want to keep that because that's the heart of how a lot of these things will happen. And with that kind of voluntary base, you can build inclusion. You can build a sense of inclusion that welcomes people. And that plays out because that's not remotely a disability issue. That's about citizens. And that means that we'll have caring neighborhoods for everybody. In caring neighborhoods, we have interdependence, not independence, because people
through this voluntary network of inclusiveness into neighborhoods, take care of each other. You know your neighborhoods. You know your neighbors. And say hi. And sit on the back porch and have tea. And do all those good things. But with that spirit underneath, you build strong public institutions because you're participating in them, and that means people are concerned about and involved and engaged, and that means that you have strong services. You have public services for police and fire and support systems that work for people, and that's because you have this deep underlying commitment. But that takes leadership, and the leadership plays itself out in a number of areas, and we have some really good news here because there is some really good access to housing, and we note later that we could use more, but there's some really good efforts in housing, and there are some really good services that support people to be in community and able to help one another. One of the other underlying elements here, this is an intergenerational community. And there's a whole bunch of layers of that, but that means that people know each other in many ways and care for each other in many ways, and they are generous with each other. The people who are generous with each other are able to appreciate the beauty of this place, because this is a beautiful place on the river with lakes and rocks and trees. And we're going to break into a song by but if you have that kind of spirit and that kind of community engagement, then you can appreciate that. We know that we've already got some jobs. We want to keep them. That would be a really good thing. And we want to hang on to the existing opportunities we have for connection and to keep on building that, because these interconnections are how we build the future we want. Now, given that.
Jack?
Yes.
Do you want to just
given the summary that Jack just gave of the things we want to keep and hold on to, are there any things that people want to add in that moment?
Yes, of course.
It's already up there, but just the thing of jobs, I think one thing to be clear, jobs would be minimum wage instead of next to nothing. So I think that's a huge piece that a lot of people face. So I think if we just add that part of jobs.
So that kind of creeps also into the do better.
Absolutely.
Yes, it does. I'm glad I noticed that. Yes, and Jack, have you got the portable mic there? I think we may need to meet in the middle. I can only get this far, so you've got the people on that side of the room.
Okay. I think one of the things that I certainly want to keep, and I think many of us in this room do, is staying connected to people who have a common vision and a common sense of what it means to belong.
That's great.
One thing that is up there I don't think was mentioned was our transportation. That transportation is basic to the quality of life for anybody that's disabled. That it's gone down the last little bit and we're hoping to improve it.
So that's coming into some is happening and kind of comes into the do better. Anything else on the things we want to keep before Jack summarizes do better? Okay. Thanks for that. Okay, just if you get that microphone back to the Jack bed, that'd be great. Thanks. Yes.
Okay, sorry about the transportation. You're absolutely right. It was looking right at me and I just scanned over it. But my defense, not that I need one, is that I knew it was coming up again. So, we have a lot to build with and a lot to build on, but some of the groupings here are are pretty obvious. The support services are always in a delicate balance, and there are people who don't have enough support to be the full participating citizens they would like to be, so that's an issue. Transportation, and accessible transportation, and that includes not only buses and so on, but also sidewalks, pedestrian access, access to public buildings. The whole issue of accessibility and transportation is a big theme here. That includes access to public buildings and just the whole community. A little subset of that that was sort of interesting is that it'd be really helpful to have a very public community calendar so you know what was going on more easily so that you could get to it. And I stuck it together because if you have accessible facilities and accessible transportation and you know what's on, you can actually get to it. So there's a strange and interesting loop. There was a sense from some people that we need to keep working on keeping our communities safe. And I lumped that with putting all people first, using a strength-based approach, building on our community attitudes. And that becomes an education issue. Education not only constrained by the school system, but education for all of us. Skill building, education for all, educational supports. And we come back to two big ones, housing for all, jobs with real paychecks, that in turn addresses the issue of poverty. All of that is going to take leadership. And clearly, this community has a lot of experience with leadership, and what you want to do is keep on doing what you're doing and do it better so that we can make headway on some of these things that we need to work on.
So Joseph and Shane are going to pick up any comments from the group about anyone who has some points they'd really like to add to the do better. Anything that from your table discussion, there's a few more words you'd like to add into what that means or something that was missing.
Always encouraged to hear a conversation about affordable housing being built when I'm not at the table. This is one of the things I'm constantly getting on my mind. I'm really excited about this particular piece of the conversation. So what we have to remember also is that it feeds into the job creation piece as well. When you spend $1 million on affordable housing, you create 13 jobs. You lower the amount of strain and pull that's being put on your education sector, being put on your emergency services, being put in the court diversion because you're providing people adequate house to home. The big key here is that when we're arguing for the development of affordable housing and developing of more housing in general, we can't just leave it at that. What we have to say is that it has to be adequate housing. It has to be housing where we're engaging the public and the private sector. And many times the private sector are missing from the table when we're having these discussions.
One thing that was said here at our table and Cal taught us was that it was really important to stay present in your community so that you can also teach through your presence, and that you need to really stay steadfast in good, healthy community life, and that that creates a real sense of belonging. So the piece really about really being present and teaching through our presence was interesting to me. I wanted to highlight.
Hi. I get to be a privileged member of Brockville, so I thought what I hadn't heard and I would like to see up there is just more organized events for youth other than sports. I think there's lots of good sporting events here in Brockville, but for those that are not interested, I would like to see more events for youth to be up there.
Okay, I was at a conference on the weekend, and something I heard somebody say, which was so simple, but it makes perfect sense, was that if people could just simply remember a time that they were excluded, and what that felt like, it would make inclusion so much simpler and so much easier to have happen. And that was specific, I think, in our schools, but I think it's true of any environment. If you just remember what it feels like to not feel like you belong, it's so much easier to make sure that other people do.
May I say something about the importance of music? We have lost a lot of music in the elementary schools. I would like to see that come back in a way that every child has the opportunity to at least sing in a group and to benefit from the immense, immensely good side effects of singing. Every child has a voice. A lot of people grow up not knowing that they could sing. They were told they couldn't or there wasn't an opportunity. And I really do think that as a community we need to put pressure on our board to reintroduce music at the elementary level when the children are still have growing brains, plastic enough to absorb and learn and benefit from the music and all of the related skills that come with being trained musically.
Because I think that is a vital part of any community. And it makes me think about what Brockville is really good at. And we have so much talent here, and musical talent, but also the theater talent that is in this community really needs to be expanded upon. And if there was a way to engage community theater again for the youth of our society, I think that would be a real great plus.
Anything else anyone wants to add into the room right now on the Shane?
Christine. Not just the musical part, also the physical part, where everyone can participate with whatever they have in a sport together as a group. I feel that's more community-based in the schools to have the children be able to participate no matter what disabilities or abilities they have. And I think it's more important that we keep that in there as well and improve it more.
I'd like to add to that as well. I think what we're talking about here is a creative community. And a creative community tends to be an open community. It tends to be an inclusive community. I'm an artist myself, and I've been around artists all my life, and they tend to bridge all forms of community and all forms of culture. And if we instill this and keep it instilled in our community, I think we will advance, because the creative ideas also spark other things in the creative realm, which is that have to do with community. So I think it's a very good thing.
So we've captured that. Thank you for those additional contributions and additions.
what we'd like to do is have the person who agreed or got voluntold to stay as the person who was the table host, if you will, the anchor at the table, if that person will remain there and everybody else moves, we have a final round of questions. Thank you. Here we're going for the last round. Everybody got a place to land. So this is the how do we go forward from here? How do we go forward from here? What can citizens and neighbors do? What can community and voluntary organizations do? And what can I do for you to think about personally? So here's the process we'd like to suggest. You've got a flip chart on your table that gives you a way to record your ideas about what can citizens and neighbors do going forward.
Yeah,
and so if you'll write down all the ideas that come up that you think about, you put them there, and then think about what can community and voluntary organizations do. So get all of your ideas in each of those areas, and you can just record them on this poster. And then about 10 minutes into this conversation, we're going to come around with a colored post-it note for everyone personally to be able to write down your answer for yourself. That is the answer to the question, what can I do? So everyone will have that note. So you're going to have a collective think about neighbors and citizens and community organizations and voluntary organizations. If you haven't met each other, please do that. Have at it. You've got about 15 minutes for this conversation. Rock and roll. Thank you.
That's why I was
smoking. As you have this conversation about what citizens can do and neighbors can do and what community and voluntary organizations can do, would you please add onto the bottom of that big poster paper, just list what the places are that people at your table are spending their time in a voluntary way. So where we volunteer, just get that list. I want to capture that. Where we volunteer, just add that to your brainstorm. Okay, hopefully you brainstorm some things in each of those areas, citizens and neighbors, in the area of voluntary and community organizations. Could you please pass the green post-it notes, one to each person, so you can write on that note what you will do. Here's what I can do going forward. What can you do to create community, belonging? What will your personal action be? Shane and Joseph are coming around, and we'd like to hear what your top idea is, the idea that's got the most energy, that had the most energy in your table's conversation or your topic, in the area of what citizens and neighbors can do, and then to hear your favorite idea about what voluntary and community organizations can do. So we want to just hear that out loud, and when it comes to your table, if it's already been said, give us a different idea.
Okay, so moving forward from here, we came up, I'm going to kind of merge a bunch of ours together. For citizens and neighbors, we talked a lot about unplugging everything that's going on around you and being, kind of opening up your eyes and your ears. Not making it easy to read right there. Aware of what's going on around you and respectfully challenging any limiting beliefs that you might have. And for the community and voluntary organizations, we thought that just keeping this question alive within your agency is really important so that you can help to grow and develop that.
And we're going to be collecting all of these posters. We just wanted everyone to hear in the room some key ideas.
We're up here at the front. So what citizens, neighbors can do is that, again, it was similar to the other table. It was to make sure that we keep the conversation alive, to get involved, encourage others to speak up, and protect the things that we have and are most proud of in our community here now. Plan, think together, encourage one another to be together. What community and voluntary organizations can do is to think about who's not present. So it's easy to think about how we can be helpful to one another when we're in the room, but who's not here is a really important question for us to be thinking about. And that we need to keep thinking about accessibility, public spaces and places and groups and collections, and that accessibility isn't just about ramps and stuff, it's about attitudes and us being together as well. Anything else, group? Team? Nope.
Okay, so moving forward from here, what can citizens and neighbors do? You know, rally around common causes and really do your homework and work on bringing people together. So we, you know, mention events like this, so getting politicians involved. Really advocating for change. Small neighborly or large neighborly acts of kindness. So, you know, Kathy mentioned when her neighbors are away, getting their kids on the bus or just inviting somebody over for a cup of coffee and how that really just turns into networking. So just all of us talking and letting everyone know what it is we do and what it is we believe in, what it is we, you know, we advocate for, and getting those messages out there. Another idea was making sure parents pass along their knowledge to their children. So, you know, we have a lot of influential leaders in our community, and just encouraging them to pass along what it is they know and what it is they believe in to their kids. What can community and voluntary organizations do? We were just so impassioned about the first question, we didn't get to this one. So we'll just say the same as everybody else. You know, inclusivity, keeping the conversation going.
Shane, can you grab, let's get a key idea. Oh, you got it.
We, as far as what can citizens and neighbors do, we thought that checking in on each other is a good one. Taking part in community events, we'll ask someone to come. We were talking about the example of possibly this being three times, this event being three times the size it is, because you've invited someone else and someone else has invited someone else. And there you exponentially you expand that way. The other thing is trying out something new, that's something outside of your comfort zone. So a lot of people are comfortable within even volunteering within a certain space or a certain area of things, getting outside of that and trying something new. And then paying it forward would be the next thing. As far as what can community and voluntary organizations do, go the extra mile when people ask for help.
Yes.
So don't just take it to the mark, take it beyond the mark. And this gets passed on, and it also gets paid forward more often as well.
What can citizens and neighbors do? We said, and it's an ongoing theme of the tables ahead of us, check on each other, know your neighbor, be aware of what's happening in your hood, this line here,
Do unto others as you'd like to be treated unto yourself. The golden rule, help others. Be friendly, positive. And lastly was walk. Walk your neighbors. Walk your neighborhoods. Take control and ownership of them. What can community volunteer organizations do? Initiate discussions, awareness. Recruit. Yes?
Okay, we're starting to have some overlap, of course. So for what can citizens and neighbors do? We talked about leadership involvement, extending invitations, inviting people to come along with you. What can community and volunteer organizations do? We talked about leadership, more of these kinds of things, facilitating thoughts, thinking, organization, actively supporting people. And what we were talking about in terms of that was, I mean, I was specifically speaking about children's events, and one of the barriers that I'm discovering for children to participate in community groups is if they bring somebody with them to provide additional support, often they're not, that adult isn't allowed in the group because they haven't been screened, because in this day and age where volunteers and staff have to be screened to be around vulnerable populations, just because it's a person I've chosen and I believe is safe and I've checked her out doesn't mean she's able to be in that environment. So that inherently prevents so many people from being, so many kids from being involved in those kinds of community activities. So I think that that extends to any kind of community activity. If we could find a way for any community group to provide its own method of meeting those exceptional needs that come up, so that people don't have to have somebody touch them in order to attend, but they can be prepared previously as to what might come up, but it would just allow for a more inclusive experience for everybody if that could be the case, and it would seem to be a pretty simple thing to do.
So what can citizens, neighbors do? We said keep in contact, keep connected, volunteer, and educate, and awareness, I guess, relates to being in contact and connected. Somebody always has something in common with someone else, so you know, if you're interested in something in the neighborhood, talk to someone and make them aware of those things, and you know, good things will happen. Okay. What can community and volunteer organizations do? And let's ask them what they want, and teach everyone how to live through that. Access or accessibility, and collaboration, working together, you know, across voluntary organizations. You know, there may be one person involved in multiple ones and be able to connect a network through that. Yeah, more choices. Teach youth new skills. Yeah, absolutely.
Who haven't we heard from?
So there's a desire, obviously, to continue to help people in need, and part of that is being a good neighbor by introducing themselves to each other and getting to know each other, getting more out to more people, have to share ideas and learn more about actual advocacy education as opposed to just how do we lend a helping hand, how can we actually affect the change we're looking for. And a lot of that comes from shifting the idea of just being taxpayers in the community as more towards continuing to nurture that community capacity by building neighborhoods and partners.
if we can, thank you for those. We heard from everybody the key ideas from your chart. What we'd like to do before we share some closing slides that actually take this fabulous bookmark that is a gift for each of you. We've got this bookmark come alive in a slideshow. So we'd love to share that with you. But we'd like for Joseph and Shane to be able to come around and just get a few things from the tables that people have said they're going to do. Just let's get a couple of things, and then we want to collect those because we know you'll remember. When you do leave, we're going to invite people to put that green post-it note up on the wall so we see the collection of personal action. But let's hear a few things in the room that people are going to declare out loud that they intend to do.
Encourage others to speak up and speak out.
I hope to continue to serve on boards and committees that have a common set of values and a vision to make things happen. And I hope as well that we continue to create that vision in our children. Somebody mentioned that earlier. I think that's fundamental. We're not going to be around forever.
The next community meeting, I will bring one new person.
I'm a real advocate of volunteers. In fact, I made my profession around teaching and training volunteers. I heard recruit, recruit, recruit. And I think one of the pivotal things about volunteer services is that organizations have to come to the realization that in order to recruit people and sustain a framework of volunteers, there needs to be some resources put behind that. And I'm not talking about, you know, a couple of hours a day. I'm talking about major resources put behind building the capacity of volunteer services. It's a never-changing evolution, volunteer services, and the volunteers of yesterday are very different from the volunteers of today. Leaders lead leaders, and I believe in that principle very strongly. And so one of the things I plan to do is to work on building infrastructures so that we can have sustainable volunteers in the community that I live in. And I think the best way example I can give to you is that over the last little while I've been involved as a trustee with Champions for Kids. When I decide to leave that role as a trustee, I will only feel successful if I know that when I leave that, I've left somebody who's going to take care of those events that I started for Champions for Kids. So the whole idea of leaving that legacy behind so that you are continuing to build and you leave those volunteers ready and willing and ready to go, go on with things. So that's what I hope to do.
That was really good, Anne. Thank goodness I'm driving back with you today. You have just a driver who will always stay for Anne. I think one of the biggest things is also bringing people to the table. Because I think sometimes, I mean, even on my way here, I think sometimes we talk about exclusion versus inclusion. And I think it's really important that we start acknowledging
that people with quote disabilities are valued citizens of this community, and should we not look another way? So I think bringing people to the community, or bringing people to the table rather, from all angles, whether someone has a disability or not, because I can tell you right now, the experience that someone goes through is a life-changing, and will have a lot more impact on the issues that are pushed forward. And I wish people with quote disabilities would also run for municipal and provincial, who can really make a difference. Also, work with the community to include, work with the community as a whole that involves everyone. That's just not single, not one person, but that involves everyone. So I think those are really, certainly that I'll continue to bring back and bring people with different experiences moving forward. Thank you.
We really appreciate the energy that people have put into the conversations today and will be picking up the pieces of paper that are there on the table, or would it invite somebody, since they got sticky stuff on the top, you can take them and put them up on the wall. And if people would take the green post-it notes, that is your action, and put it in that space. Joseph is pointing to that space. It's the big I will spot. It needs your commitment there. And incredibly, we've actually hit 4 o'clock. And we're going a few minutes over time, are we?
Oh, that's okay. Okay.
Okay, it's almost four. We have a slideshow we want to play, and before that, we just want to see if there's anyone who's got anything else that they want to say in their personal declaration or to the whole before we have this wild Scottish music and the animation of this postcard. You're taking this like you're going somewhere. Where are you going? You're headed somewhere. Are you? Yeah, well, I'm sorry, it's not Irish music.
That's it.
As if you knew.
I just want to say, somebody said what you do personally, it starts with you and then it goes again and again and again. And I think what you present personally really helps other people, models, you're a mentor and that sort of thing. And I think that's really, really important.
I think that's going to be the change you want to see in the world. Thank you, Gandhi. Indeed it is.
Thank you. couple of things that have come across to us. On April 3rd, from 9 a.m. to 4 p.m., here at the Brockville Convention Center, there will be another workshop that one of our coordinators at BDACI is running. We have flyers out on the table for you to take. It's called Building Local Capacity for Housing Needs. And Linda has also would like me to remind you to post your green post-it notes up on the white sheet that says, I will. Without further ado, here's Elizabeth Saw.
Hello, my name is Elizabeth Saul. I am the president of Brockville People First Chapter. I would like to take this opportunity to thank you for coming out today. Hosting this event has been a wonderful experience for People First Brockville. It has been challenging and exciting for us, and after today, I can say it has been very rewarding. The purpose of this forum was to discover why people are not included in their community and what we can do to change that. I am encouraged that so many members of the Brockville community, of our community, have come together here today to open the doors for inclusion in Brockville and surrounding area. I would like to thank Jack Pearpoint and Linda Kahn for sharing their wealth of knowledge and skills with us today. It has been very rewarding to have them assist us in building a just community that can welcome the gifts of all. We would also thank all the dedicated volunteers who worked to make this event possible. We would like to thank the management and staff of the Convention Center for their service and warm hospitality. Once again, we would like to thank all of you for your commitment to making our community more inviting and inclusive. We will keep you informed about upcoming events, and we hope you will be able to join us as we journey toward a community where everyone can experience respect, equality, inclusion. Please enjoy the rest of your evening and have a safe drive home.
You be ready.
Okay. This is Joseph Boisvenu, and we asked to just have this brief conversation with you, Joseph, because we've just finished this remarkable event where there have been at least 60 people in the room, and every time we asked how this diverse group that included the mayor and the head of the YMCA, just how did they come to be in the room? The answer was you.
Yes.
Would you
please
share what you did?
This is an important learning for everybody.
Yes. In order to bring so many people to events like this, there was a lot of phone calls, emails, and going into organizations, public places, and advertising over World Wide Web and with the Recorder and Times, EMC, radio stations,
the whole
kit and caboodle to advertise.
How many phone calls do you think you made?
I've made quite a number. We have support service groups here, employment services, support services.
And you just
services.
Went down the list.
And I was given a list of over 60 organizations
and you got almost every one of them.
Yes.
All bent.
Do you think the personal phone calls make a difference rather than just a blast of email?
The personal phone calls do make a difference rather than a blast of emails, because not a lot of people do understand you when you're trying to email them. If you talk to them over the phone, while they have the information in front of them, you can explain in plainer language.
So how many calls to per organization do you think you made? I'll bet it was more than one on some,
yes,
for some of them.
Yes. I've made phone calls with the chief of the local police.
Mm-hmm. Who was here?
Deputy chief was here. And phone calls with Recorder and Times, EMC, 104.9, JRFM, Ivan, Bruce Wiley, who is the morning breakfast show host of Hot Topic. I connected with him.
Were you on the show?
I was on the Hot Topic show.
So you've got a whole new career lined up here.
Live on air. Really, what I, as an event coordinator, your spokesman for your committee.
That's great.
Well, brilliantly done.
Well,
and
congratulations.
The mayor came.
And the mayor stayed.
And
he made a good speech.
Thank you.
I think he saw his community that you organized.
Yes.
Explore their capacities. That's,
yes,
really pretty exciting.
Really, congratulations.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Well done.
And I would like to, on behalf of People First Brockville and People First Ontario, thank you for facilitating these workshops in our five communities.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
We really appreciate the invitation.
Yes.
It means a lot to us too. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks so much, Tony.